Listening Library presents Trickster's Choice by Tamora Pierce. Read for you by Trini, Alvarado. In a time of fear, the one who I promised will come to the Raka, bearing glory in her train and justice in her hand. She will restore the god to his proper temple and his children to her right hand. She will be twice royal, wise, and beloved, a living emblem of truth to her people. She will be attended by a wise one, the cunning one, the strong one, the warrior, and the crows. She will give a home to all, and the Kudurung will fly in her honor. From the Kiprish Prophecy, written in the year 200 HE. From the Luaran Conquest, New Rulers in the Copper Isles, by Micha Bourdeurs of Queen's Cove. Published in 312 HE. In the bloody decades before the year 174 of the human era, the Kiprish Isles were locked in strife. Rival branches of the royal house traded the throne on a number of occasions. In turn, the crown had lost control over the warring houses of the Raka, or native, nobility. Scholars said of those years that only the jungles prospered, for the trees and vines fed on the blood of the Raka. During this time, the Isles exported more slaves than imported them. Victors sold their enemies into the eastern and southern lands only to enter slavery in their own turn when they lost the next battle. Queen Imiari VI of the House of Haiming made repeated attempts to negotiate peace among the Raka. Her efforts failed. She was overthrown after 12 years of rule. Her successor and murderer, Queen Dilzubai, also a Haiming, favored those nobles who supported her shaky claim to the throne and imprisoned their rivals. The glorious days of the copper-skinned warrior queens of the Isles were over. On the mainland, the pale-skinned Easterners, called Luaran by the Kiprish people, saw the disorder and the wealth of the Isles. Ritavan of Lonman, younger son of a lesser noble house in Maran, found opportunity in the Isles' disorder. He raised funds and allies among the realms of Tuzain, Gala, Tortall, Maran, Sarain, and Tortall's southern neighbor, Barjun. Barjun was conquered by the Tortall in the year 378 HE, giving Jocin III of Tortall control of the eastern coastline from Scanra to the southern delta of the River Drell. For an army, he summoned younger sons, adventurers, and mercenaries, all bought by the promise of the Isles' wealth. With them came battle mages trained in the arts of war at the university in Karthak. Ritavan and his chief ally, Ludus Jimagen, son of a Tirin merchant clan, placed their souls in pawn for the gold that bought the services of their battle mages. They bought all the Raka nobles they could in advance, promising them status when Ritavan sat the throne. The first assault came in stealth on April 5th, 174 HE. The invaders struck not the capital at Rajmuat, where rival Haiming cousins fought over the crown, but the stronghold of the noble house Malubasai on the southern island that bears their name. This most powerful clan was taken completely by surprise. Their homes were left in ruins, their warriors in mass graves, and their descendants in chains, all at the hands of the Luaran mages. For the next 7 years, Luaran ships and armies ranged the islands from Malubasang to Lomban, from Imahin to Tongkang. Lesser Raka nobles and various clans, seeing how the wind blew, offered their allegiance to the conquerors. These became the lesser nobility of the Isles, allowed to retain lands, freedom, and lives, but taxed into poverty after their strongholds were destroyed. For the greatest Raka nobles and the royal house of Haiming, the Luaran offered only slavery or death. On Midsummer's Day, 181 HE, the first Ritavan king was crowned as ruler of the newly renamed Copper Isles. The domination of the Raka people continued. The Luaran nobles, once tailor's sons and blacksmiths, landless younger sons and mercenaries, took for their new houses and fiefdoms the names of the land and the old noble houses. More Luaran arrived to settle and do business. Marriage among the Raka was encouraged for the Luaran lower classes, producing a multitude of part Raka servants and slaves. The Luaran were there to stay. Like most who lose such struggles, the Rakah declared that only war and the divine realms explained the failure of their patron god, Kiprioth, to defeat the Luaran. The Luaran priests taught, and the Rakah people believed, that Kiprioth's divine brother and sister, the war god Mithros, and the great mother goddess, had overthrown him. It was these gods, the priests of both races said, who took the right to govern the islands, while they gave Kiprioth lordship only over the local seas to keep him occupied under their eyes. Soon after the last battle of the Luaran conquest, an ancient priestess gave voice not to her own prayers, but to the banished god Kiprioth. His promise was passed from Rakah slave to Rakah freeman, from Rakah mothers or fathers to their part Luaran children. Kiprioth told his people that the efforts of the Luaran kings to erase the Hyming line had failed. One branch of the old royalty yet survived. The queen's prophecy is his promise that, from that surviving branch, the one who is promised would come. She would be the queen with two crowns, chosen by the god to lead the isles and those who loved them to freedom once more. Chapter 1. Parents. March 27th to April 21st, 462 HE. Pirate Swoop, Tortall, on the coast of the Emerald Ocean. George Cooper, Baron of Pirate Swoop, second in command of his realm's spies, put his documents aside and surveyed his only daughter as she paused by his study door. Alianne, known as Ali to her family and friends, posed there, arms raised in a player's dramatic flourish. It seemed that she had enjoyed her month's stay with her chorus relatives. "Dear father, I rejoice to return from a sojourn in our gracious capital," she proclaimed in an overly elegant voice. "I yearn to be clasped to your bosom again." For the most part, she looked like his Ali. She wore a neat green wool gown, looser than fashion required because, like her da, she carried weapons on her person. A gold chain belt supported her knife and purse. Her hazel eyes contained more green than George's own, and they were set wide under straight brown brows. Her nose was small and delicate, more like her mother's than his. She'd put a touch of color on her mouth to accent its width and full lower lip. But her hair? George blinked. For some reason, his child wore an old-fashioned wimple and veil. The plain white linen covered her neck and her hair completely. He raised an eyebrow. "Do you plan to join the players, then?" he asked mildly. "Take up dancing or some such thing?" Ali dropped her pretense and removed her veil, the embroidered cloth band that held it in place, and her wimple. Her hair, once revealed, was not its normal shade of reddish blonde, but a deep, pure sapphire hue. George looked at her. His mouth twitched. "I know," she said, shamefaced. "Forest green and blue go ill together." She smoothed her gown. George couldn't help it. He roared with laughter. Ali struggled with herself and lost to grin and reply. "What, duh?" she asked. "Apart from the colors, aren't I in the very latest fashion?" George wiped his eyes on his sleeve. After a few gasps, he managed to say, "What have you done to yourself, girl?" Ali touched the gleaming falls of her hair. "But duh," she said, voice and lower lip quivering in mock hurt. "It's all the style at the university." She resumed her lofty manner. "I proclaim the shallowness of the world and of fashion. I scorn those who sway before each breeze of taste that dictates what is stylish in one's dress or face or hair. I scoff at the hollowness of life." George still chuckled, shaking his head. "Well, duh, that's what the students say." She plopped herself into a chair and stretched her legs out to show off her shoes, brown leather stamped with gold vines. "These look nice." "They're lovely," he told her with a smile. "Which they is it that proclaim the hollowness of the world?" Ali flapped a hand in dismissal. "University students, da, it's the silliest thing. One of the student mages brewed up a hair treatment. It's supposed to make your hair shiny and easy to comb, except it has a wee side effect. And of course, the students all decided that blue hair makes a grand statement." She lifted up a sapphire lock and admired it.
"So I see."
George thought of his oldest son, one of those very universities.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.